In the last few videos, I've described the electron transport chain, which uses the energy from electron transport to pump protons out of the matrix of the mitochondrion and into the intermembrane space. Proton pumping by the electron transport chain results in a high pH in the mitochondrial matrix relative to the pH in the intermembrane space. Remember that pH decreases as proton concentration increases. Thus, there exists a protonmotive force across the inner mitochondrial membrane. This force is made up of two components. The first is the electrical potential across the membrane. The accumulation of positive charges in the intermembrane space makes that side of the membrane positively charged relative to the matrix side, which has a relatively negative charge. This means that, given the opportunity, positively charged protons would spontaneously move from the intermembrane space side of the membrane to the matrix side because they are repelled by the positive charge and attracted to the negative charge. The second component of the proton motive force is the proton concentration difference across the membrane. If given a pathway, for example through a channel, protons would spontaneously move from the intermembrane space side into the matrix because particles diffuse from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. ATP synthase is an enzyme that allows protons to move from the intermembrane space into the matrix, down their electrochemical gradient. A representation of the essential subunits of the enzyme is shown here. You can see that it is composed of many protein subunits, some of which are transmembrane proteins, making the FO sector, and some of which are peripheral membrane proteins, making the F1 sector. A few things to note. 8 identical transmembrane C subunits are arranged in a cylindrical ring. 3 alpha and 3 beta subunits of F1 also come together in a ring-like structure. Joining these two rings in the so-called central stalk is the long skinny gamma subunit, which contacts the top part of the C subunit cylinder and extends into the center of the alpha 3 beta 3 cluster. The alpha beta cluster is also contacted by the B subunit, which makes a second or peripheral stalk connecting the alpha and beta subunits to the FO sector. The 3 beta subunits contain the active sites where ATP is synthesized. The enzyme functions as follows. The C subunits, together with the A subunit, form 2 half channels through the membrane. These half channels give protons access to a proton binding site on the C subunits halfway through the membrane. Protons will move from the intermembrane space to bind to C. Then the C cluster rotates, exposing a new proton binding site to the half channel. As time passes, the C subunits will rotate completely around as shown. When the protons get to the second half channel, they are released from C and can diffuse into the matrix. The net effect of this process is to move protons from the intermembrane space into the matrix down the electrochemical gradient, using the energy from the spontaneous process to drive rotation of the ring of C subunits. As the C subunits rotate, they drive rotation of the long gamma subunit. The gamma subunit makes contacts with the 3 beta subunits. As gamma rotates, it bumps or pushes against the 3 beta subunits in turn, causing conformational changes that affect the active site and drive the phosphorylation of ADP to make ATP. The peripheral stalk acts to hold the alpha 3 beta 3 subcomplex still, preventing alpha and beta from rotating along with gamma. The net reaction of ATP synthase is shown here. One complete rotation of the C subunit ring allows 8 protons to move from the intermembrane space into the mitochondrial matrix. As this happens, the 3 beta subunits are contacted in turn by gamma to cause synthesis of ATP at each beta. So for every 8 protons that move down the electrochemical gradient, 3 ATP are synthesized, or 1 ATP for every 2 2/3 protons. There's no need for this number here to be an integer, because proton movement and ATP synthesis are not directly connected, they are coupled through a rotation of the central gamma subunit. In the next video, I'll calculate how many ATP can be made from each NADH or QH2 that gives electrons to the electron transport chain, which will allow us to figure out how many ATP can be made from complete oxidation of one glucose molecule.